Yeah, welcome to this talk. I'm going to talk about the situation about open source licenses at the German Aerospace Center where I work. This is a talk which I laid out together with my colleague Karina Haupt. She's also around here, currently in the other track, because she knows all the stuff what I'm going to talk about. But in the end, if you have questions, you can also go to Karina and ask anything. For me, as an introduction, my name is Andreas Schreiber. I'm working at the German Aerospace Center, Deutsches Center für Luft- und Raumfahrt, DLR. I'm Head of Department for Intelligent and Distributed Systems, located in Cologne, Berlin, and actually also Braunschweig. And I'm also leading a group for secure software engineering in the Institute of Data Science in Jena, which is brand new. So actually, we didn't hire any people there. I will start in December. And I'm also co-founded the company for medical applications, smartphone apps for Android, where I'm doing like data science stuff. My background is I have a degree in industrial mathematics. Started at the DLR as a mathematician like 18 or 19 years ago, 1998, and worked on high performance computing, performance improvement of fluid dynamic simulation codes and all this stuff. And this was growing after some couple of months, and then I started to do anything else. And that's part of the freedom at DLR. We can, as a research lab with substantial funding from the government, you can really work on anything else. It's a good thing. And well, DLR, the German Aerospace Center, to set the context, we are the research organization mainly. Like three quarters of DLR belongs to the research branch. We are also the space agency of Germany, so comparable to NASA in the US, for example. And we have also a project management agency, which does some stuff for government and the ministries in Germany. They are actually located here at Alexander Platz, not far away. At DLR, we are working actually on things like aeronautics, space research, transportation, energy, and also space management, and nowadays also on security and something called digitalization. It's a buzzword with every German politician takes into his mouth today. And they want us to work on this topic too. But let's see. DLR is located at 20. This is also important in the context of software development. We are currently about 8,000 people. It's growing this year a lot because we got funding for 7 new institutes this year. A lot of more money from the government for about 500 or 600 new people. And located in 40 different scientific institutes in currently 20 sites around Germany. So, yeah, of course, the site in Berlin, the major site is in Cologne, where the board of directors is located, and the largest site is Oberpfaffenhofen near Munich, where like 2,000 scientists are working. Also, a couple of offices outside of Germany, which is sometimes nice for meetings. Offer project partners a meeting place in Washington, so it's always really, really nice. And so we also work on a lot on software and software development, besides all the engineering stuff. This is based on aeronautics and stuff. And this is an important topic, but to set the scene, also software development at DLR is very diverse and very heterogeneous. We work on very kind of different methodologies and engineering applications and so on. And but some numbers are that more than 1,500 employees, that means full-time equivalents of employees, are working on software development. That means definitely more than 150 million euros per year. Personal costs just only for software development. On top of that is all the other engineering stuff like building a satellite and all this kind of stuff. It's also very expensive, but 150 million at least is pure personal cost for software development. So we are kind of the largest software houses, software companies in Germany. The characteristics of the people of these 1,500 were actually like more than 3,000 or 4,000 people are actually working on software development in part time because they are like engineers or coming from natural sciences and so on, and they did some kind of programming course at the university or something like that. But that means they usually don't have like a substantial training in software development. That's a big problem that we have to tackle at DLR. And we also have a huge amount of software projects actually going on. We have no numbers here because we are not able to count the number of software projects. It's difficult. Also, we use a huge variety of different software technologies. That means, for example, at least I counted this like 10 years ago, at least I counted there more than 30 different programming languages which we use. It includes, of course, the usual stuff like Java, Python, C++, Fortran. These are the big four, and also more like commercial stuff like MATLAB or LabVIEW, LabWindows, and other program systems. ADA, we use ADA a lot, and these kinds of tools. And also a lot of different libraries, of course, as any software developer do with us today. Of course, we have a lot of the stuff that we are doing and producing is open source, as well as proprietary, and we also use existing open source software, and also we use existing proprietary software. So we have many different licenses which we have to deal with in our daily lives. As I said, we have a huge number of software projects. To get an overview about this project, we tried this a couple of times in like 10, 15 years. It's really not possible for us. So we tried to have some kind of registries, and we have tried about via the way of the pass of funding to find out how many people are working on software and what kind of software they're working on. It's just not possible to get a complete list. That's part of the problem. Well, examples for open source software from DLR is, I've like three examples. They are really kind of typical for DLR's open source software. The first is like the tool, it's called, it's like a game, so. ASMY tool, it's an Earth system model evaluation tool. Earth system modulation is like we are doing a model for the whole Earth system we are living. And a lot of people in this area develop their own models, and what we have is like a tool to compare these models. And it's very important for the community that this is open source and that anybody can contribute. So there's no repository for that on an open GitLab server, and anybody can add their Earth system models and then run the evaluation and compare their own results to results of others, for example. This is widely used, and this is really expanding currently, this kind of project. And also, I took the next example. Sumo is simulation of traffic, of urban mobility. It's actually developed here in Berlin, and also Berlin and Berlin Adlershof, the DLR Institute for Traffic and Transportation. And it's also used by many cooperation partners in universities and companies and so on. This is especially interesting because of Sumo, we are part of the Eclipse Foundation since this year. Sumo is now an Eclipse project. And the third thing is RCE, which we develop in our department. A group in my department is developing software, the remote component environment, which we use for distributed simulations for a various kinds of applications. And this is very also typical for a number of other projects. Usually at DLR, as well as at other research institutes, they have a lot of people with ideas, and knowledge in their minds, and very different kinds of knowledge, like from design of aeroplane wings up to the costs of a plane, for example, in the aeronautics domain. And what's usually happening is that they writing their knowledge down as some kind of a software tool. It's not like that they're producing documentation a lot, rather produce some kind of scientific papers, of course, because at DLR, because we also have to produce a couple of papers every year on for scientific conferences and so, but many people are actually today writing down their knowledge as software. And more and more of the software is, of course, open source today. What we are doing a lot is combining and integrating the software, for example, to enable data exchange and to harmonize like data formats. We can use graphical tools, this RCD system, the distributed workflows within the DLR network, and more like not only within DLR but also outside of DLR, universities of companies, and run distributed simulations or distributed evaluation of existing hard and software designs of other people. And usually this also is, there's a huge human aspect, because from time to time also engineers come together in rooms like that. This is a facility in Hamburg, so technically University in Hamburg-Harburg, where people work with the software and collaborating, work on designs. This works very well. A lot of designs are coming out of this. This is kind of airplanes which we use in the next like 40 years or so. Especially this will be like one of the major designs of Airbus, which they push currently. And this works very well at DLR. A thing which was very complicated in this context, because for the distributed designs, also with the external partners, all this stuff should be open source. And in the past, going to this direction, we had a couple of problems with that. If this is recorded, I cannot tell you every detail, but you can come to me afterwards. But you have a lot of issues with licenses which we publish to other people, especially, and also some kind of we also have a couple of political problems when our government was giving away software of DLR to the government of another country, and they said it's open source, you can use it, for example, for like disaster management or for like tracking hurricanes and so on. And actually this was not open source, because the developers at certain institutes made mistakes regarding the open source licenses. And this, it was covered by Spiegel. And if it's in the press, then there's internally a lot of pressure to change stuff. It's a good thing. So, for example, one problem was license compatibility of the use existing software was not fulfilled. The colleagues who were involved were not really familiar with open source licenses and what they are and what are the liabilities and so on. And they also had no idea what requirements on the source code if they are using the system or producing a system open source software. So the first thing that was like 2012, Chief Information Officer. Then sent up. I have only this, of course, in German, because it's an internal document which I think I'm not allowed to present, but. So he sent around a letter to all institutes with a couple of warnings and tips regarding open source. It's more like to wake up a lot of people within DLR that this is a difficult topic and you can make a lot of mistakes which can be harmful for DLR. This is the negative side of this topic. And we also have the top positive side, and because since then we are offering help to our colleagues of TR. And that's just in the way I'm talking about it, that what kind of help and solutions what we are offering for our colleagues. In general, it's a difficult topic, and so what I found this year is a study published in a paper on the International Conference on Program Comprehension. They made a study about how developers understand open source licenses, and the underlying problem, also underlying on all topics that we had, is that developers able to understand the license and the usage of the open source license if only one license is involved. If you have multiple licenses, more than one license involved in your project, then most of the developers are not able to understand it anymore. And this is especially true for people who are not interested in software development, like our engineers and scientists who actually want to design a new airplane. But they do really not want to deal with licensing issues. And these two factors came together, which makes it in labs like DLR very complicated to improve the situation and to make everything fine for everyone. And so what we did is a couple of actions to set up information and trainings, knowledge exchange, and of course consulting and support. And I'm going through all of this. So the first thing that we set up a couple of years ago is a training course for open source licensing. It's called Legal Aspects of Open Source Usage. It's like an official training in our education program. Every employee can go on the intranet and select this program for the yearly training courses and go there. And it's short training. Currently, until last year, it was 4 hours. It will be the next edition will be 2 hours longer because of some reasons. So it's definitely not more than half a day, actually. And it's run by two persons. One is a legal expert, a lawyer, by the DLR Facility for Technology Marketing. And it's the from the Department of Licenses and Patents. So somebody also knows the law and are dealing with licensing issues in general, not only for open source, every day. And one from our department, from our facility, simulation software technology, where we are bringing in the more kind of philosophy of open source and the knowledge about software development. And together we are setting up training course. The agenda, our curriculum is like that. You have like first an introduction to open source, what is it, the philosophy and so on. And then we have of course the legal basics, which is actually in practice the longest part of the training. Then we cover a couple of things about open source, what is a software license, what's the definition of open source, and for example also cover the term copyleft, which is, as you know, important in this context. And we also cover going through to a couple of concrete licenses which are important at DLR, GPL of course, the Eclipse Working License and so on. And we are covering a couple of practical aspects, choosing an open source license, and covering the topic of license compatibility and development and distribution of open source software. And new from next year on will be that we have now an formal process how to publish an open source license, an open source software from within DLR, which we developed this year. Was approved by the board of directors, and we can add it to the training next year. So the current trainings, there are not too many people attending, but it's well distributed. We are moving around with the training through different sites of DLR every year. So that we cover a couple of sites, and what's not in here is that these people are coming from very different institutes, and they also spread the word to other institutes. We're currently in the process of evaluating this more informally with a master's student who makes a questionnaire, For all participants who attended in the past years, so that you get more information about what is useful, was it useful, and so on. Before each training, we also send people like as in other educational training course at DLR, a questionnaire about the expectations, about the prior knowledge. And as you can see here, this is the prior knowledge of open source licensing of the attendees of all the trainings in the chat up to now. Most of the people had some like limited knowledge because they had to deal with topics for source licensing in their daily work already, and they want to come into the trainings to learn more and more detailed information. And of course, a couple of people had no knowledge, some knowledge. Nobody said that he is really very fit in open source licensing. So the expectations that we also get from the questionnaires is that the people want to learn about the open source the aspects. They want to have an overview about open source licensing and so on. So that's the expectations that the people have, which will be fulfilled. And the ratings that we get from the participant after the workshop are okay. So most of the people think the training was good. A couple always think it's better than good, and always a couple of people think it's not very spectacular. So this is the open source trainings that we have in place, and we also like offered and conducted this training to other people outside of DLR. For example, other institutions, the Resource Lab and the Helmholtz Society, or also for a couple of companies. So this is also like requested by others. And we also have an open source brochure. This is an I forgot one. So we have an open source brochure with information about legal aspects of open source software. It contains part of the topics which we cover in the trainings, basics about open source license law. The brochure was developed by a law firm here in Berlin actually, and funded and published by the DLR Technology Marketing. It has two main chapters. It covers the one case if you have unmodified code which you want to distribute under an open source license, and the other case if you want to distribute modified open source code again. And in both chapters, we have lists of all liabilities for licenses which are used at DLR. Oh, I see, this is not complete. It's not only BSD, but also Apache, GPL, Python, public license, and so on. And also, it's grouped into different subgroups with licenses with strong copyleft, weak copyleft, without copyleft, well, with special rights. So it's structure. And the brochure is like has some practical information with checklists people can go through and ticks a thing if they their own software project fulfills the license requirements and so on, and also some kind of informational boxes with detailed information or explaining of very like complicated words and so on. Also, I feel kind of decision trees where people can like choose a different license or what kind of license to use. Currently, this brochure is available in German only, which is, we had a lot of requests from other people from other researchers in Germany, and so the printed edition is out now, and we are working on the next edition, which will be also available in English, and also available under a Creative Commons license and available to everybody. Hopefully beginning of next year, this is one part, information and trainings that we offer within DLR, and we also have knowledge exchange. Of course, if you think of knowledge exchange, usually you can think of wikis, and also we have an a wiki in place. So the situation at DLR regarding wikis is like, until a couple of years ago, we have almost all of the institutes, they have had their own wiki installations with different software. So in my department, we have had a more and more wiki installation at the time. And since 2013, we have now a central wiki installation based on Atlassian Confluence. And we can add different wiki areas to that. We have, for example, areas for software engineering, for events, and also for other administration information at DLR and so on. And also we have now, since last year, a section for, it's called DLR Open. It covers all the things, all the topics which are open, like open access, open data, open science, open hardware, open, I don't know, whatever. So the largest sections are currently open science, open data, and open source. And in this section, we have categories like topics, certain topics regarding to the major topic of source, for example, tools, literature, in Q&A section, and a section for events. And the information that we have here is available in the web already, but it's really not, it's really a bit complicated to get it all together. You can search for all the terms on Google or Bing or whatever, and you find your answers. But what we did here, because the situation at DLR, because people don't want to search the whole web all the time, we condensed the information and made some kind of summary with links to more detailed information, so that so our colleagues can go to this place and they find everything that's really important and necessary for them. So it's our single point of information at DLR, for open source and, as I said, also for other topics. So currently the most growing part actually currently is open data and data management, which is also an important topic. We also have, besides this wiki, we also have something that we call it Wissensaustausch Workshop, because the official name is in German. In English it would be Knowledge Exchange Workshops. This kind of workshop has been set up since like 5 or 6 years. It's a kind of workshop where people from all the institutes, from many institutes, are coming together at one place, face to face, and they talk to each other and they exchange their knowledge. And we have workshops for different kinds of topics. The first one was for software engineering, and then we have things like visualization of huge data sets and autonomous flying and photonic systems. And since last year, we also have a workshop series for DLR Open, and the first edition last year was about open source. And the nature of this workshop is that they are repeated. There's an initial workshop, which is also centrally funded by DLR, regarding the education and so on. And then it can or should be repeated every year. So this year we had our second DLR Open exchange workshop, more or less a focus of open source of software for geodata processing. Not a specific topic, but a lot of people at DLR work with geodata and geographical information and so on. And we are also running, our department is also running the software engineering. This is also a workshop where we last year also had the topic of open source software licenses. And we also are talking about not only for open source, by the way, but also we are currently, not only talking, we are working on a topic called inner source, where we are applying the concept of open source within our lab. Sharing source code, so the source code on a common version management system, and doing all the things that the open source community is doing, but for internal projects. That's currently our main focus in our work. So these workshops are, or as any information that we have, open to all DLR employees. We had like a limit of 60 participants for each workshop, so that it does not become too large. And it's an interactive program with like small talks or lectures to set the scene and give some basic information about the topics. And personal introduction of everybody, as you can see here. So everybody has to introduce himself with, in this case, is writing their knowledge on a poster, which then they present to other people. Then we have also always like lightning talks or small talks, and of course discussions in small working groups. And as you can see here, well, actually this is Karina. She's, as I said, around in the next room. This is like some practical focus. Writing or painting your poster and explaining, trying to explain the poster to others, which we found out is can be very difficult if somebody is from a completely different domain and has a completely different way of thinking, and we have people who think completely different, as you can see here. And to mention his name for the recording, Philip Martin Fischer, he's very strange, and you can see in this picture. And if you talk to him, you will see that the picture is the most clear thing in it. Yeah, he works on designing new satellites, actually. And the satellites actually are flying, which you would not believe if you talk to him. So the expectation on topics also we made questionnaires for evaluation of the outcome of the Wissensaustausch workshops is like most people are interested in knowledge exchange. That's what they expect, and the expectations were also fulfilled by the people, for the people. That's a good thing. So the actually for us the method is that in general these knowledge exchange workshops work very well. And you also have like, especially for the topic of open source, on the workshops that we have on open source, a couple of findings. So we learned what we knew in part already, that open source stuff is already widely used at DLR or at least spread at DLR. And most people today are only using existing open source tools, libraries and other tools. And most of our own research today is still closed source, or the software related to our own research is today still closed source. This is the situation the next year. But many people want to publish their software because of different kind of pressures from outside, for example. If collaborators say if your software is not open source, we're not going to collaborate with you. Or if some funding agency is saying if your software was a product, the product of your project is not open source, you're not getting the funding. So there's a lot of pressure. And so more and more people at DLR are interested in publishing their own software. And one of the major things that we're missing actually is that came out of this workshop is that a formal process for publishing open source is missing or was missing at DLR because many of the employees had problems finding the right people to get approved for the open source publishing. Usually the situation is the default who should ask is the head of the institute, but this information was not enough for many people. So we made a formal process where you have to go, where you have to get your approval, and what kind of stuff you have to do before you can publish your code as open source. And the major topic in this process, of course, just to mention this, is the topic of export control. So if you must fulfill the export control roles of our country, of Germany in this case, for example, this prevents anything which is related to military software cannot be published as open source. Unfortunately, it happened to a lot of our projects. And usually, people don't see even if there's a military use case or a dual use case. It also happens for a couple of projects in our own department. And here, he had planned to really open all of our software as open source, but it was prevented and forbidden. And that was a serious topic. Well, and yeah, for all steps in this process, people can also always have like consultant and support. And what we set up in place is a couple of institutes and departments are offering help. For example, for the general licensing questions, things like property rights and so on, the DLR, the Department for Technology Marketing, is helping, the lawyers that are working there. We also have a legal department, as every huge organization, I guess, and they provide like legal support in general. They have to approve like anything that looks like somehow official. To sign something, it must go through the legal department. And our group is giving advice in terms of, well, for license compatibility questions or for license selection, or other things related to actual software development. And what works really well is that we was it 10 years ago or so, we set up an email address, a central email address for all these kind of topics. Open source at DLR. People can send all their questions to this email address, and we distribute it to the right department. And this is used very extensively in the last years. So actually, it's a good thing to have a central address that we distribute. Typical topics that we have in the field of consulting and support is, of course, criteria about choosing an open source license, what license to use, best practices for open source projects, what library to use, how can I incorporate a library, or how do I publish open source. And also a topic that came up a couple of years ago is the migration from commercial or proprietary software to open source software. So, for example, which is a really huge example, is that a lot of people are using MATLAB, a commercial system for programming, basically. It's a programming language, and widely used for engineering tasks and simulation and so on, optimization and many other things, robust design, visualization and so on. But it's quite expensive. I think like the license per year is like about 10,000 euros or so. And it's quite expensive. And so a couple of people want to get rid of this cost actually and use open source replacements for that. And for this example, we are now, since a couple of years, pushing to use Python and all the Python libraries instead of MATLAB. It works very well. So a couple of institutes at DLR decided that no new code at all will be written in MATLAB again, but everybody should use Python. And as I said, the legal department is giving support on licenses. We also have a couple of default licenses which are approved by the DLR's legal department. So this is rather short, because we have to go to them with a new license, and we did it for three licenses, simply IPC, Apache 2, and Eclipse Public License. These are the licenses which every DLR employee can use without further notifying the legal department or without asking the legal department, because they are considered harmless for DLR. Of course, many more licenses are used at DLR, but these are the three that are officially commons. And another important thing in this area is that we are not going to develop our own open source license. There was all the couple of times there were questions about why do we design our own like DLR public license or something, because everybody else has its own license. NASA has a NASA public license, but the European Space Agency has its own license, which is really a monster of open source licenses with multiple choices and multiple decision points and so on. And there was a lot of pressure for DLR, but internally from a couple of people who wants to have an own open source DLR license. But we decided like 3 years ago that we are not going to this way. We are quite happy with that, because if you go to the OSI website or so, you find, I think, in my opinion, is you find your licenses with fits your needs in the, really, I don't know, 70 or 80 projects of already existing open source licenses. So there's, in my opinion, no need to design your own licenses. Yeah, and also for support, in the wiki we have a Q&A section where people especially can ask questions related to open source licenses or licensing. Yeah, so also, so the key messages of this talk is that so our approach tackling open source licensing issues at DLR, which is very heterogeneous in terms of technologies and in terms of organizations, internal organizations. SAP, our first thing that we offer specific information for the employees instead of making the formal process first. And then the second thing will be provided time and space for them to exchange knowledge and to talk to each other. And what we know today is that a couple of people within DLR know each other and they know who is working on what topic. Much more detail than a couple of years ago, and they also do help them each other regarding also open source licensing. That helps a lot. So we have a lot of indications for that, that this kind of information flow happens. And only now, only afterwards, only after all the information is in place, we are now going to provide some documents, some formal process which people from quality management, people who are making the quality management systems, they are demanding some kind of process definition. So we are giving it to them. So the feedback that we got from our colleagues is all the actions that we are doing, the feedback is very positive, and we also are getting a lot of tips and hints, and we have a lot of specific action items from the workshops that we are doing for further steps. And we also, taking care of that, we are really fulfilling all action items. That's really important, because we have trust from our colleagues. So we are not the people who are dealing with software and software development are not doing really well. Yeah, and the good thing also is that our approach is copy-paste scanning. So, by the Helmholtz Society of Fossil Traps in Germany, they are adapting this kind of stuff. And also, just yesterday came from the US, from a conference, where our approaches will be also used in the US for the US research labs for the initiative Better Science Software Development. Their plan is that we just translate our German text to the English website, but we will figure out if we are going to do that. That will be our methodologies and ideas will be spread to the USA in the next months too. So really nice thing. So I'm done. If you have questions, just ask me or maybe later Karina, and thank you for the